Good evening and welcome to the Irish Art Show, broadcast from the Scientology Community Centre. Tonight we're delighted to welcome a four-piece band who've been playing together around Dublin for the past few years. Please welcome the incredible Blues Umbrella.
Well, they call me the breeze. I keep blowing down the road. Well, they call me the breeze. I keep blowing down the road. Ain't gotta meet nobody. Ain't carry no heavy load. Ain't no change in the weather. Ain't no change in me. Ain't no change in the weather. Ain't no change in me. Ain't hiding from nobody. Ain't nobody hiding from me. Well, they call me the breeze. I keep blowing down the road. Well, they call me the breeze. I keep blowing down the road. Ain't gotta meet nobody in this world called my own. everybody. We're called the Blues Umbrella. Here's some more blues. Here's one from JJ Cale. You love me, and I can see through that. Lies, lies, lies. Now tell me, babe, why you take my time? You get the thrill of playing with my mind. Lord, you did it to me. See it in your eyes. Lies, lies, baby, why you take my time? You get the thrill of playing with my mind. Lord, you did it to me. I see it in your eyes. Lies, lies, that was one from JJK. We're going to do one from Bessie Smith this time. It's called Gin House Blues.
Yeah.
Somebody give me some change.
Yeah, that was Gin House Blues. All right, we're going to do a Mark Knopfler song next. This one called Setting Me Up.
Give it up, baby.
pushing around. Oh yeah. Okay, that was a Mark Knopfler song. We're gonna do some reggae this time. Here's one from Bob Marley. Trying to track me down, and they say they want to bring me in guilty while they're killing of a deputy, while the life of a deputy. But I say, I shot the sheriff, but I didn't. Oh yeah, bit of reggae there. Okay, we're gonna leave you with some BB King. Bit of fun. This is Every Day I Have the Blues. Every day, every day I have a blue. Every day, every day, every day I have a blue. Yeah, you see me worried. You, I hate to lose. Well, now nobody loves me. Nobody seems to care. Thanks for listening. Cheers.
Wow, I'm absolutely blown away by the sound, the look of all these rock gods on stage. Fantastic. It's just unbelievable. I really enjoyed every part of the performance, and I'm really looking forward to interviewing the guys here and seeing how it all started. Well, guys, you're very welcome.
How are you?
How are you doing?
How are you doing?
And Brian, very welcome to the Irish Art Show.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Absolutely blown away by that sound. I just didn't know where to look. The whole, the visuals, the sound.
I don't know where to look either. Just look at him, he keeps me on track, you know.
We don't know what we're doing half the time.
So PJ, it's great to have you back on the Irish Art Show.
Thank you.
Because of that, we're going to start off with you.
Okay.
I believe that you're the one who created the name of the blues umbrella.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it was, you know, trying to come up with a name of, you know, the blues has subgenres and stuff like that. So we have blues, we play country, we play roots, Americana, and it's kind of like an umbrella of the blues. So that's where the name came from, really.
So where did it all start for you?
Well, I started playing guitar when I was 15. I started with the blues. My dad always had Eric Clapton records on in the house, and B.B. King and Freddie King, people like that. So, yeah.
Did you teach yourself?
Yeah. You can tell, can't you?
No. Definitely not. Did you teach yourself? Yeah.
Well, more or less self-taught. Yeah.
And what about your parents? Were they part of the music scene?
No, they weren't involved in music, no, but loved music, you know. Mm. There was always music playing in the house, but I don't know. As soon as I saw my first guitar, something clicked, so just went from there.
And did you know you were going to be then on stage? Was that like, you know, I always say that there's a big difference between playing a guitar at home in your bedroom to transitioning to being on stage.
No, I definitely didn't play it to want to play on stage. No. Yeah. I just wanted to learn how to play the blues, you know. And then just kind of went from there, you know.
And what were your music influences?
But definitely, you know, Eric Clapton, you know, all the old blues guys, Robert Cray, you know, John Mayer, John Mayall, Cream, all the old stuff, really, you know, that's what got me into the blues.
Mm. And what about you, Brian? Are you the same?
Pretty much the same, yeah. I mean, I decided when I was in school that I wanted to play guitar, you know, it was sort of the cool thing to do, and everybody was in bands, and then, you know, my parents were quite musical as well, so there was always music in the house, and they were really supportive to me, and you let me, you know, have the shed down the back and have loads of musicians in and out and rehearsing all the time, you know, so I think I decided really young that the minute I was out of school, I was gone, and I wanted to be on stage and, you know, be in bands.
Who influenced you to be in a band? Was it a front man, or was it somebody that you just went, you know, you saw on TV and you went, you know, I'd like to be him?
Well, at an early age, like, Mom was into, you know, the typical, like, Elvis and the Beatles and the Stones and all that, and she was a great American country lover as well, so, you know, you had your Johnny Cashes and, you know, listening to the radio back then was, I sound really old, but it wasn't that long ago. There was a lot of Deep Purples and, you know, Led Zeppelins and all that. And I found Thin Lizzy when I was really young, and I just fell in love with Phil Lynott and fell in love with his songs. And they always had, well, they had two guitar players in the band and harmony, guitar harmonies and all that. And I just loved it, you know. So they were a huge influence. And so I took it from there. You know, I tried lessons when I was younger, and I wasn't disciplined enough. So I sort of self-taught myself, and took it from then.
Isn't it amazing how you can't be disciplined enough to go to, say, a lesson, but yet you can sit there yourself and just mess around with the guitar?
Yeah, I think it has to be a really a love of playing a certain style or a certain piece of music, mm-hmm. that you know, was in your heart. and it's got soul. Like the lessons, I really tried, but reading music and I mean, it's like mathematics to me. I just it didn't work for me.
Switched off.
Yeah, I wasn't interested, you know.
I think you either go down that route of like, you know, all through college and all that, or else you're just at home, just trying to learn it yourself and go through the vibes of that.
And it's a great achievement when you're young as well. You know, when you're working out something that's sort of complicated and you do your own version of it and you sort of get it and you're tapping yourself in the back. And it's great.
You couldn't have had a better front man than Phil Lynott.
What a man.
You couldn't take your eyes off him. He was mesmerizing.
Unbelievable.
Actually, I don't even think he realized how mesmerizing he was.
No, I mean, he was 36 when he died.
It
was so young. But, I mean, Phil Lynott, he was so prolific. He wrote, I mean, there was 14 albums in the guts of 11 years. You know,
unreal,
that's a lot of stuff. And a lot of songs and a lot of touring and then recording songs. And, you know, unbelievable. So, yeah.
And then his mom, like, she just kept his memory alive so much.
Amazing woman.
I met her a good few times and she was so proud.
Yeah. I know.
Unbelievable. Actually, I'm just thinking before I go any further because I'll forget. So I just want to name the rest of the guys. So obviously we've got PJ, Brian, Bill and Tommy. So we don't want to leave Bill and Tommy out.
Yeah.
In that fantastic performance. Don't want to get to the end and forgot about it. Tell me, okay, I know the name Inspiration, but I know you all do separate projects with different musicians, but how did you come together or who actually started the band? Was it you, PJ?
No. Brian had been, doing a gig. Do you want to?
Is it my fault?
It's your fault.
It's a good fault.
Well, me and Tommy, we all gig around for years and years. Me and Tommy, the drummer, have been playing in the Porterhouse in town for, I don't know, the guts of 20 years. And we've been doing the Monday night sessions for a long time. And after COVID, we just, it came up that we needed someone for the Monday. And I'd been chatting to PJ and it was a very natural thing, asked him to do a few gigs and it worked really well. So we just continued on and we're keeping it up and we just love it, it's really good. Just enjoying it.
It's good fun.
Yeah.
It really comes across on the stage. Like that makes such a difference to a performance.
Yeah, well,
everybody's half asleep on the stage, but they're playing the music like they're putting the audience asleep, no matter what you're doing.
Yeah. Well, I suppose the blues thing, you can do your own interpretations of stuff, so it's not like the record, like note for note, So, for two guitar players and any musicians, it's a really nice gig to have, You always grew up going to Slattery's or Arthur's or whatever and seeing all, the likes of Pat Farrell and all these guys, all that generation, and they all played so well. Like the blues thing in Ireland and especially in Dublin has been, it's been huge for so long, it's created so many great musicians, look who came out of Ireland, Gary Moore and Rory Gallagher and loads I could mention, but there's been such a great interest in Ireland, and we're good at it as well. I think our Irish musicians have a lot of soul, which is sort of half the battle as well,
And all those guys that you mentioned, I don't even think they'll ever be forgotten.
No,
they'll always be part of Irish history that will be remembered.
Yeah.
And the one thing that I liked on stage about you guys is that when I was watching you, I love the way you get into your own zone of, in your own thoughts, and you're just stuck into the music, but yet you're still connecting.
Yeah.
I really like that. Mm. Especially when you're answering each other on the guitars, it's just so good. Mm. It's just really like, and yet you just look like you're just, like there's no audience there. It's just like the two of you just connecting with each other. It's wonderful.
Sometimes it's, we have these chats all the time about, after a gig, sometimes you might be going, I didn't play very well, or else I played really well. There's a thing when you're playing any instrument. If you're thinking about it, you're gone. It's over. If you can't get lost in the moment and try and just be in yourself and be yourself and go with it, that's when you're onto a good thing, you know. But the minute you have doubts or you're thinking about who's over there or who's looking at me or whatever, it's over, you know. It's
being authentic to yourself.
Yeah.
And not even maybe interested in what people think of you. Just being yourself and being your best part.
I mean, look, everybody has things and you can let them creep into your head, you know, but I try, even in an atmosphere like this, there's no audience, you know. Mm-hmm. We just drove up and you have to get out of the car and just perform. But, you know, you sort of think like you're in your own sitting room at home and just playing away, but, you know, and get into it, you know.
I love the bit where at one point, I don't know, you went like this, yeah. Like there was an audience there. Yeah, it was just brilliant. Actually, talking about Phil, because Phil, Leonard, I don't want to get like this... go is that you're a musical director on the famous Vibe for Philo.
Yeah.
Does that continue? Yeah. Is that still continue, or is that a one-off thing?
Well, it's over now. Like the Vibe for Philo was Smiley Bulger's idea, and he started it when Phil died, which was 1986. So it was going, and Phil was 36 when he died. So it went for 36 years, and his plan was when it was the 36th year was to finish it. So we did the last one. I think it was last year, and it's over. Now, it's been taken over, and it's called something different now. You know, there'll always be something going, but it went for 36 years, and as a tribute to Phil Lynott, you know.
So how did it end after 36 years, you would think?
It was actually really emotional.
Yeah,
it was
I'd
sad.
Be crying, like.
Yeah, I mean, there was a full team involved, and there was a lot of people involved. I was involved for maybe... I don't know, 15 years, you know, sort of heavily involved. And I enjoyed every minute of it, you know, and got to play with a lot of the guys out of Thin Lizzy and all that, you know. So, a dream come true for me. But I like the way it stopped, because Smiley's not well, and it just, you know, people are getting older and...
Yeah, and maybe the 36, because he was 36.
Yeah, kind of.
Was his mom at that one? Did she see the 36?
Well, his mom died a few years ago. I'm not sure the year she died, but no, she wasn't at that one, no. But she was at, you know, the last one, coming up to the end of her life, you know. She was always involved.
Wonderful, absolutely wonderful.
Great
memories.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking now, and I asked you about your guitarist, but when did you realise, PJ, that you could actually sing? Was that always there, or did you just... decide after the guitar I must sing a few songs?
No, I never really considered myself a singer as such, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. I just said I'd give it a go, you know.
Sorry, I'm not a vocal. What is he like?
I think everybody has a voice, you know.
No, they don't.
To some extent, you know.
They don't.
It's all about getting it out there and the confidence, I suppose.
Have you never met any tone deaf people? No.
But, did you always sing in bands?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never really wanted to. I just did. I don't know how it happened.
I love that. I never really wanted to be that front singer, but there you go.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about yourself? I know you do backing vocals.
I do. I mean, I'd love to be... I can sing and I love singing, but I just don't have it in me to step up and be the front guy in a band, you know.
You'd probably feel naked without the guitar in front of you.
Yeah, it was never in me. I mean, as I get older... sometimes I'm stuck for singers and I'm like, why don't you sing, you know, to myself. But I think if it had happened, it would have happened by now, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not that guy really, you know. I like being in the background.
Do you like being in the background? I love that.
No such thing. Yeah. No such thing.
I think there's a front man in there now trying to come out.
Yeah. You never know.
Been in the background, that's the best one yet.
When they're wheeling me on.
Well, I have to say, there's such a great vibe between all of you guys. And, you know, it's just wonderful to interview people that have just such good laughs.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Like that, as it comes across on stage, the buzz, I suppose, of all of you there, yeah.
Nice one. Well, thanks for having us.
Yeah,
here.
No. Before you go, is there any more things you'd like to do for 2024? Are you just going to be on the same vibes or anything planned? Or
I think, you know, after this, I think this is the sort of first thing we've done. You know, we haven't been together that long and we've been doing our regular gigs. We want to do more gigs, you know, and we'd love to do some festivals and blues festivals. And, you know, there's a lot of gigs I've done with different bands over in Norway and Sweden and all that, and they've so many different festivals over there. So yeah, hopefully we'll get some other gigs and
I say you'll be getting a lot of gigs. Let's.
It's just trying to get everybody together, you know.
I know.
Because we're all doing different things, so mm-hmm. it's trying to lock everybody's dates in together, you know. And
yeah.
Make we sure were talking free. About that recently, that, and a lot of musicians are the same. So beforehand, before say COVID, that we've changed, that we all kind of are more mingling with other musicians, or we're kind of saying, are she free or is he
yeah.
free?
Yeah.
Whereas beforehand, it would have been just like maybe just a band that worked together all the time, and that was all they did.
Yeah.
And now we're just have all these like co-creations going on, collabs
yeah.
happening all
yeah.
the time.
Yeah.
Which may is a good thing as well.
Yeah, well, it is. It's a great. I think it's great for musicians to play with loads of different people.
Yeah.
You know, I've always been like that. You know, I don't think I've ever been in one band. More probably because of the politics that goes on in bands. You know, but like I did love changing from, you know, just different setups, you know,
yeah.
different singers, different guitar players, different drummers.
Yeah.
You learn a lot
it
from
expands
people.
You
know?
It expands
yeah.
who you
yeah,
are,
yeah.
absolutely.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, listen, guys, thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
For being
cheers.
On the Irish Art
Thank
Show.
You. Thanks a minute.
And keep doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Being magic. Well
nice.
Done. I'm just blown away. It was fantastic. I knew it was going to be great when you were stepping up, you know. I love that. It was great. So thanks very much,
We've
guys.
We've done our job.
Yeah.
Thank you
so much. Thank you.
So much.
Well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen at home. What a show. I'm telling you now, I enjoyed every single moment, and I'm sure you did, dancing in your seats at home. So thank you on behalf of myself, Angel, and all the crew here at the Irish Art Show. We'll see you again next week. Until then, thank you and good night. Thank you.